had a little pre-meeting, the four of us, to discuss, and I think Ellen's point's well taken, that you quickly and easily slip into the negativity of the whole thing, but her point well taken is you have to remain positive about it, and I think that's what art can do. And one of the beautiful things that I think art is able to do, and I think about the ancient cave paintings, and you know, before language existed, or writing, I should say, you know, the ability for an image to express an emotion, like, well, here we are, here's the game coming in, and you know, this is a wonderful thing, and you know, it's to tell a story. So images have always have the ability to tell a great story. And in thinking of in terms of environment, art can do the same thing, whether it's celebrating, or you were describing a piece that was kind of a forewarning of things to come. I think it's a great vehicle because it transcends all cultures. You know, this is a horrible example, but when you see a bright red Coca-Cola truck going by, you don't read Coca-Cola, but you know by the font that it's Coca-Cola. So that's something that has become ingrained in the subconscious, and that's what art can do. If I think about Pablo Picasso's Guernica, which was a statement about the horrors of war, I mean, that's just such a powerful image that says so much. So that's where imagery has this great force to reach us at a very, I hate to use the word primitive, but it is. There's different levels of our consciousness. And what we need to do, and I think this is what art can do, is that it can touch that sort of subconscious level.
Into landscape. But John, you seem to approach it really more from still life. Mm-hmm. Tell me about that transition. Tell me about what it is. Tell us, your friends here. what is, if environmentalism isn't pictured in the landscape, then how is that message encapsulated in still life?
Sure. No, I think that the sort of macro microscope and telescope kind of combination of the exploration and exposition of this topic is pretty vital. I've observed that in a variety of examples, including my father's work. But certainly, my pursuit, my drive to that end is to communicate all art being about communication fundamentally. To communicate my own personal experience of reverie in nature, that getting you mentioned being in the dirt, and I with total respect, I can only offer that my favorite part of my process is getting into the dirt as well, and you know, going and digging in the woods and sorting through interesting rocks, and that's, you know, it's the best part of being an artist is that you don't have to let go of your childhood in that way, and. So you can see in the pieces in this collection in particular, all the shells are shells that I've collected and sorted through and have chosen for their particular quality. If in a still life, those can be framed as objects of importance, which they are, if they can be elevated and the statement can be communicated in a way that enhances the feeling of reverence for those objects, as humble as we kind of are tempted to regard casually regard them, then the purpose of the work has been realized.
The next generation embraces. Who takes this mantle and moves forward with it? How do we diversify this effort? Because it really is a very diverse effort. There are some cultures who are afraid in the outdoors, quite simply afraid to be outside. But all in all, how do you stop for a moment and really appreciate what we have, because it is from that sweet spot that then you can move forward to truly make an effort, make a further effort in conservation or to protect that which you can. And I think a photo or a piece of art allows you to do that. It kind of forces you to do that for a moment, just to stop. And in our world, we're always looking for new partners and new ways to tell the story, certainly through art. The Nature Conservancy wrote an interesting article about art, and Andy Warhol, apparently the man was a conservationist. I mean, who knows? You know, he actually loved his land very much, and he wrote passionately about it. But again, is it a personal thing, or whatever it may be, from the movement of conservation, we are always looking for partners. And quite frankly, wherever I can find inspiration and love, whatever you may call it, I'm there. I mean, some people question the motives of people why they did what they did, and I remind them that Teddy Roosevelt did what he did because he was a big game hunter. He wasn't out there adoring, you know, the cathedral of trees. That man wanted to hunt. And because he wanted to hunt, we have the national parks we do, quite simply. He was passionate about it. So it's, and from our world, it's what partnerships can we work with to try to produce this lovely inspiration and the message of conservation to keep this idea moving forward in this world?
The Stewardship Foundation.
Well, I happen to have one other prop. In 1991, and this shows you that not all things are planned, that there is serendipity in the world. And I was working in my main studio, and I had done a series of paintings using apples. And just for the, more or less the fun of it, I took a real apple, and I painted it like the earth. Okay, and it was kind of a lark, and I put a little price tag on it because my wife had recently been to a yard sale, and there were a number of these little tags laying around. And as an artist, you often put in items for texture. Mm-hmm. And what was surprising about this little project was it became, when people saw it, they immediately saw an environmental message. And I have to be honest that it was not created for that purpose, but people saw, you know, the fall of the apple in the Garden of Eden, and people started to see all this amazing thing. And really, that's what got me, brought me to the realization that art had such an amazing message to portray. By a series of fortunate or unfortunate events, it ended up actually in the White House for a number of years and during the Clinton administration. And so the painting, the title of the painting is called Stewardship, but that was only because of the response of the painting. And that's what really got my wife and I thinking about how we could try to encourage other artists to use their art as a messenger. So we have spent the last 10 years promoting the idea of stewardship. We've traveled to universities, we've worked with conservancies, and we've encouraged other artists to do the same thing, to either donate their artwork or create artworks of message. And it's been reasonably successful. And you know, again, this was something that wasn't planned, but it really worked out marvelously that people can identify with this. And so the original stewardship painting, and I wonder what the title was. I don't even know if I had a title for it initially, but people saw something in it. So that's really was kind of the birth of the idea of the art of stewardship, was to create that kind of venue for artists to say, hey, you have a voice. Mm.
Obviously, it's a family business. Visual arts, but is the work of foundation also a family business?
I mean, I would describe myself as an alternate member. No, I mean, you know, like a lot of our family undertakings, I'm a partner to a certain extent. The vision, really, as my dad has articulated, belonged to he and my mom. You know, if I bring anything, it's as a technical millennial. I am, I'll be 34 in the spring, and so I'm on the very outside edge of that generational block. I am the last member of our society, that group of people, who remember life before the internet. I was five when a computer was brought home and plugged into the wall in the house that I grew up in. I look across that divide with, let's say, some concern, because for all the connectivity that's offered by it, it is a tempting siren song pulling us away from the experience of nature that's so valuable. And as you mentioned, the idea of interactivity being vital to the role of conservation. So if I have any thing to offer, it may be that I can appeal to the other young creative people, younger creative people, and get them to collaborate in the work of expressing appreciation for nature. It's fabulous. Technology is always a part of the creative process. I use it in my work. There's no doubt about that. As you mentioned, the cave paintings that in Lascaux, for example, in France, They're not, you know, like by the mouth of a cave. They're really deep in the cave, way too deep for there to be natural light. So those, some of the first recorded expressions of human interpretation of the natural world, required technology. You needed fire to paint them. So there's a natural partnership between art and technology, but I am a believer in the importance of analog expression in a partnership with technology. I am here to remind you of that.
This is sort of the second year of a partnership with the Plein Air Society group. And we do a lot of agricultural easements, so we do a lot of preservation of agricultural land because as a way of life, A, it gives us local very good crops, B, it keeps people farming the land, and if they're not actively farming the land, I guarantee you it would be a housing development, especially in Chester County. It's amazing. And not coming from Chester County, it's amazing to me what's happening in Chester County. So this partnership with these artists, they're going to go to some of these eased properties on agricultural land and paint, and then we're sort of going to try to conglomerate that with the food grown on the farms and the plight of the small family and sometimes organic farmer. So it's not just about conserved lands too. We know that in a lot of circumstances we need people to be working these lands so that they can remain open and viable. The word open space to some just means stack. It's a stack. It really doesn't translate well much anymore. Working lands is sort of a mantra. So in an area we've got such magnificent agricultural soils, let's keep it in farming and sustainable practices and good practices, and call to attention to the plight of the farmer who's trying to keep this land in farming so that you can buy local produce and it's coming from nearby. So that's a new partnership we're embarking on. I think that's quite interesting and exciting.
Mobilizing this for a large population that you're communicating is very aspirational place. And thinking predictively, thinking about what battles there might be, what sort of concerns there might be in the future. What are the subjects of environmental art going to be in the near future?
Well, 9 years ago, I was electrified when Barack Obama was elected president. It inspired me to do a painting, which was actually shown here at the Somerville Manning Gallery. Mm. It was called One World, because mainly, not just because he was a black president that was elected, but the response of his election worldwide was so encouraging to me. I just saw people kind of celebrating worldwide. So I created this painting called One World because it was my celebration that somehow we had made a step closer in terms of thinking about the world as a unified place. Perhaps I was mistaken, but what the painting portrays is, you know, the earth is a finite place and on a step with doors, but we don't know what's behind those doors. People can speculate, people have often speculated about the future. No one's done it with any great accuracy ever. So,
Except artists.
Yeah, well, yes, of course. So again, can we inspire politicians? Well, it's possible. The painting, again, through a series of events, actually ended up at the White House. It was there for 8 years, and this is the former President Obama looking at the painting, hopefully asking about the painting. So that was, you know, did I influence any politicians? Well, I don't know. But, you know, at least my work was there, and maybe it caused one person to think about something. Maybe the president. So you know, that's very encouraging to me, that me, an uneducated painter, could have a painting in the White House in a place of some celebratory note. That there is something, there is a message that can be received. So to me, that's very positive.
Ways, but are there subjects that are needling your through you now into some form of action in the future?
Mm-hmm. I did a commission painting, which I don't often do. It was, have any of you ever heard of mantis shrimp?
Sounds delicious.
Well, it's a small creature about that big. It is like a miniature lobster, like a shrimp. And it's one of the most exotic and unbelievable creatures in the world. It can see, you know, let's say our spectrum of color is about this big, the mantis shrimp's spectrum of color is this big, and it's one of the most dazzling creatures, and you know, and yet no one here, and I didn't know either, about the existence of the mantis shrimp. So I did a painting to raise awareness about the mantis shrimp, and it's like this, it's every color of the rainbow, and it has these amazing sticks that can punch open a clamshell. But this is a very fragile creature that will be affected by the temperature of the water, the acidity of the water. So, you know, I made some special trips to the Baltimore Aquarium because they have a mantis shrimp. And he was very shy, or she, and you know, I just waited and waited for him to come out, and finally it came out. But it's like, wow, you know, I had no awareness of the mantis shrimp, but what a dazzling creature. So that's education, that's inspirational, you know, that's awareness.
If you can put it in the vision of what you're talking about and have it impact the life of a shrimp,
mm-hmm.
you know, just like he used an otter, it's very powerful because it's something we can grasp and not feel overwhelmed about. And like, oh, why even try? This is just too big. Why even try? So that's brilliant. It's actually mm-hmm. brilliant.
But how do you feel that the patron can get involved, both in the environmental movement and in the art world?
I mean, I think that if you're interested enough to do the wonderful work of feeding the creativity of artists themselves and supporting the sphere of you know, various creative fields, hopefully having a piece of artwork hang in your home every day will motivate you to participate even further. And you know, if you're doing the work of presenting a collection to the people in your own sphere, the ripple effect is you know, the last best hope we have, I think. You know, I think that if you're the kind of person who is interested in that subject, that the art is merely the gateway drug, the physical art itself. And so the participation in something like foundations that conserve land and resources and promote awareness of environmental issues is the next natural step, hopefully it becomes as much of an extension as it can be of the participation and the appreciation of the literal artwork in person.
Yeah, and I found that people who have responded to my paintings that have a message like that is very encouraging, and they are fascinated all the more. Other than, there's nothing wrong with having a painting that exists for beauty alone, but there's something added extra to the notion that this has a significance above and beyond just being attractive.